Which is very, I still think it's very close. Because it's done, yeah. We will start. And I'm very happy to introduce Professor Pincel.
Pincel.
Okay, I'm still struggling with the pronunciation of the name. First I pronounced it T, but that's not there in the pronunciation. From the University of California in Los Angeles. She has a very long and illustrious career that sort of covers many elements, including having worked with the government of the state of California, having played an important role in the running of a very sizable NGO, that's my understanding. And she works on cities, which those of you who've been around for some time know, remember that we once had a megacity project, but that's really most of the urban sort of history that we have. We didn't focus more on rural issues and rural things. So I was very happy that she showed an interest in coming to us, because I think cities deserve more attention. And she'll be doing two seminars. Today is somewhat more practical, if you like, focused more on how data are used in certain, in a specific context. And then towards the end of her stay, probably in sort of the first half of December, we'll do one more seminar which will be more conceptual, thinking about cities in the city.
Yes.
So I should have waited until after the time up there, because we're still growing, but nevertheless, I'm going to hand over the mic to you and ask
you. Thank you. And thank you so much for coming. It's a pleasure to be here. In fact, it's quite an honor to have been invited, and it's been so far extremely stimulating. In fact, I thought I would get more sleep, but my mind is just alert at night. I'm sure some of you have had that experience being here. All these different ideas and ways of being that are so important, I think, today in a more globalized context, to at least have some understanding about, or at least exposure to. I have found that it's the first time in my life I've lived somewhere where I do not speak the language and I cannot read the language. And it really provides a very different perspective on how you understand things, if indeed you do. But at least one is forced to use one's other senses quite a bit more. Visual, sense of smell, sense of taste, and it's really very, very interesting. So I, like I suppose many of us, have ended up working in the realm I work in gradually and in part by accident, by chance. Funding comes through, a person, you meet a person, you become interested in an idea, and a work product and a direction evolves out of that. And my main set of interests has been actually humanity and nature. And so when I saw what the Institute here does, it was very exciting to me. And to get a sense of, to be able to learn what that means in this context, which is very, very specific. So I began the Center for Sustainable Communities, and in California, the center came about as a result of grant funding that I received. The name of my center was given to me by my grantors. I had a much complex name. But it's stuck, and so my interest has really been, as I said, in humanity and nature, but as we have become more urbanized, and urban areas have increasing impacts on landscapes and on people and on resources, my focus has been more and more to really try to understand how these complex urban areas resource themselves and perform internally relative to some very specific kinds of questions. So I was very taken by the concept of urban metabolism as a framework for the quantification of flows. It doesn't tell you why, it tells you how. And order to really reduce environmental impacts, we need to have a much better sense of the how, of the why of these environmental flows and how they are distributed on the landscape, because it's not neutral. Particularly in the context that I know about in the United States, there's an enormous amount of inequality, I think probably more than there is in Japan, from what I understand. And social equity and how those environmental flows are organized is a very important theme in our work. So to help cities reduce their environmental impacts in a way that is more equitable, or at least has some concern about equity, you need to be able to quantify the flows. You need to quantify the consumption. Who's using the flows? How much are they using compared to someone else? You need to assess the social environmental impacts. And so if you're burning fossil fuels for electricity, the places where you're burning those fossil fuels will have more environmental impact in those neighborhoods than elsewhere. So the distribution of the consumption, the impacts of the consumption, are part of understanding those flows. And then, because I think it's insufficient to simply know things and not do anything with them, with that knowledge, I am very actively engaged in policies, programs, and implementation strategies in the state of California, in the county of Los Angeles, the city of Los Angeles, and various groups of organizations. As much as I think an academic can be, I'm happy to talk about how difficult it is for academics to actually do that if there's a question period that's of interest, at least in the U.S. So, as we know, these flows are the results of many factors. There are rules, there are regulations, there's conventions, soft kinds of agreements, and on the kind of soft infrastructure side. And then, on the hard infrastructure side, there's cheap energy. Energy is still very, very cheap. Fossil fuel energy is enormously cheap. Actually, solar energy has become very cheap. But wind energy has become very cheap. But how those interact and interplay really affects those resource flows in the cities and how they're distributed. And then, of course, the degree of consumption, which, of course, in the US case is very high for everything. So we track flows using big data. And I have come to using big data. Actually, I don't use it directly myself, but I am the intermediary for accessing big data, which is a very political activity in the context of energy in California. It requires engaging with regulators, with administrators, with bureaucrats, signing non-disclosure agreements, having very, very, very secure data protection at the university, so no one can hack and get into the data. And so my role has been to identify the data needed and engage in a very difficult negotiation with the holders of the data to be able to use the data. But as I say, not all data tells a story. So data is worthless, in my opinion, unless you have an intent to do something specific, to understand something with that data that can then be translated into a kind of that understanding builds knowledge that you can do something. So there's a lot of emphasis today, as you know, on big data. We need big data this, big data that. And we have a lot of big data. But the big data itself doesn't tell you anything. It's just a bunch of numbers or flows that are unintelligible, really, unless you have a perspective, a lens, through which you are looking at that data to construct a meaning, to construct a story, to construct intelligence. So we use big data to tell stories, to provide insights into how cities work and how they can change. We are very intent on actualizing the power of that data in the analysis. As I alluded to, big data availability is a huge obstacle in the real world, because much of the big data is private, privately owned, or held in trust, like health data by public institutions, or economic data is held by agencies that will not divulge it because of fear of competition. So data in this realm that I work in is I suppose in essence secondary information that's collected. It's not prime. I'm not out there measuring the electricity use in a home myself. I use secondary information, but this secondary information has so much personal and political weight that it becomes very, it has to be protected. So the first project that we engaged in was to collect building energy data. In California, in Los Angeles, and I think most cities in California, 40% of greenhouse gas emissions are produced by the transportation sector. We know about gasoline burning and greenhouse gas emissions. But 40% is produced by the energy used in buildings, the gas and the electricity. And that has remained fairly invisible. It's a very, very important sector if we want to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, to address building energy use. So I like to, when I give presentations, say, if you went to buy an automobile and you had a lot with many different kinds of automobiles, and you did not know how much gasoline any one of those automobiles used, it would be very difficult to choose among them. Do I want a high gasoline using vehicle, a low gasoline using vehicle? Buildings are exactly like that in terms of public policy, in terms of moving a greenhouse gas emissions reductions agenda forward. They're blank. We don't know. Is this a high meeting? Does this building use a lot of energy? Does this building use a lot of energy? We have no idea. So in this case, big data becomes critical, because only with a big data set can you begin to match, as I'll show you, those buildings with different characteristics like their age, their use, the socio-demographic characteristics of the people who live in those buildings, and so on. So I was able to get, and this is the first of its kind in the US, I know that there's someone in Kyoto who's been collecting, not Kyoto, Osaka, who's been collecting building energy data, so I've heard of it. And then we developed an interactive web atlas that provides access to the largest and most disaggregated building energy data available in the country. And this is an ongoing tool for understanding energy use in buildings. And so what it does is it provides knowledge about building energy use. And we have our primary data is address level billing data. So my electricity bill, natural gas bill, yours, and so on. For electricity and natural gas. And then that provides us the ability to quantify how much is being used to target programs and evaluate results. Because like many places, we have many programs for reducing building energy use. You can apply for a rebate for a new washing machine or refrigerator or insulation and so on. Do these make any difference? How important are they? Who applies for them? Has it made any overall impact? All of that needs to be understood. But we can't if we don't have the actual data, which no one has done, surprisingly enough. Not even the agencies have had the authority to get the individual private data from the utilities. It's a completely incomprehensible situation. So when I first started this, I wanted to do the urban metabolism of Los Angeles County, very ambitious goal. And I started with energy data. And I went to the State Energy Commission that regulates energy, that regulates where power plants are sited and so on. And I said, do you have this data? No, we don't have it. What? You don't have this data? No, we can't get it. It's private data, it's owned by the utilities. So it's a long institutional story, but it was absolutely stunning. And so that made me upset, unhappy, and I started on this path to get this data. So we have the individual data, we aggregate it according to certain regulations, so it can't be disaggregated for the website. And it's useful for the implementation of legislation, for local conservation, for the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions. It's actionable data. So how do we do this? We get the account, we get the billing address, we get the consumption, we map it, we join it with geographical information about locations to the parcel, and we geolocate it. We have 27 million or more raw utility addresses that we've matched to the parcel level. I have geniuses that work for me. And so it allows for the energy consumption to be analyzed by the parcel. And the parcel data is collected by the tax assessor so that we can impose property taxes. So property taxes are developed relative to various criteria, including history, and in order to do that, the county assessor has these attributes about the property. So that is the age of the building, the size of the building, the use of the building. And then we add census characteristics. Do you use, is there a census in Japan? Right. So renter owner, income, predominant language, ethnicity—all these characteristics are also collected, and so we have these big chunks of different descriptors, basically data that get merged together, and we're able to then say aggregate them to geographical areas. Neighborhoods, cities, and so on. So the database development comprises the utility billing data, electricity, natural gas, the county assessor for taxes, the parcel data, the census, any administrative boundary we determine, and then we're adding now things like solar potential. Based on the size of the building, the amount of electricity utilized, and if you want to go to zero carbon, we're starting to add what it would take to electrify the natural gas consumption. Then it goes into a big database. Don't ask me the details because I don't know how to do this myself. But it's a relational database that organizes the account level consumption and the spatial relationships. And that serves as the database that we aggregate by geographical size in order to mitigate the possibility of being able to identify an individual consumer. And then it gets, so there are privacy controls, and then it gets those aggregated tables get imported into the data, this SQLite database from which this Energy Atlas gets the name. Is that pretty clear? So let me see how to do this. I'd like to show you the atlas. I'm just a conceptual person. How do I do this? Currently to a much bigger geographical area, and the interface will be somewhat different by January. So if you do the map, what you will find is you can here in this toolbar choose the building type that you're looking for, so by sector. You can then look at the consumption here. Oops. By combined BTU, electricity, natural gas, or greenhouse gas emissions. And that we calculate on the basis of the fuel mix, particularly for electricity, of course. How much coal, not much anymore at all. How much natural gas, how much solar, how much wind, how much hydro, all of that leads to a greenhouse gas emissions number, right? And then as a total, and then it begins to be interesting. The median per parcel, the median per square foot, and residential per capita. And that begins to unpack this data in a very, very interesting way. And I'll give you a preview right now of some of our findings. We have found that building energy use per square foot with the energy conservation standards that have been developed has slowly been declining. But because the buildings are getting so much bigger, the residential buildings are getting so much bigger, that the per square foot gains are completely wiped out. So we find these anomalous situations where small houses in poor parts of Los Angeles have very high per square foot energy consumption, but per capita is much less than in wealthy. Those are, no one has done that analysis. No one has the data, which has huge social justice implications, to really look at what's going on. So the state government passes many, many rules, many new regulations about conservation and efficiency, but they don't take into account the increasing size of the buildings. Because, well, I don't have a simple answer for that. But in the United States, residential homes have increased in size tremendously, as they have in Europe and other places. With wealth, people are able to buy more space. We have a paper that's being written by one of those, my spatial analysts right now, who is showing this in very great detail. And it's completely undermining any of the conservation goals. Very serious. If we had simply restricted the size of the buildings, the residential buildings, no conservation at all, we would be using less energy. Astonishing, right? So this, having the big data, is enabling a kind of analysis that's spatially granular that could not have happened before. But it wouldn't have happened unless I asked the question. So having intention with your data is extremely important, because otherwise you just have data. How do you make sense of what you're seeing? What do you want to ask of it is really, really important. So, and then here you can go by councils of government as several cities together, cities, and then neighborhoods. And because LA has a lot of people, we can go to the neighborhood level and not reveal customer, but we can protect customer privacy. So if you go here, you can see summary statistics. So you have the population, you have the median household income, total consumption, because that's what I selected, median consumption per square foot, and so on. And then we can open the full profile. And here, you get quite a bit more information. So you get that, and then you get, some of it is masked to protect customer privacy, so, and the data might not be quite as good as it should be. And then here, let's see, here are the really interesting findings, where you can see the distribution of energy use across buildings. You can see the built space across the different buildings. Clearly, we are very single-family dwelling heavy in Los Angeles. And then the median consumption per square foot of all the buildings. And then down here, the total consumption by year built categories, the built space, the numbers of square feet by age tranches, median consumption, and so on and so on and so on, right? So it really provides a way to mine, if you're working on energy policy for your city, here you have a whole ability to actually construct policy around the built environment. We go on to surrender and honor, residential consumption for median household income. You can see how much higher it is by wealthy people. And you can also then let's see, go back and look at a table. The table here is another version of this, and you can also then select the building types, again, the consumption, and so on, and sort them. And here we have cities, but you can choose neighborhoods or bigger applications. So, I'm actually very proud of this project. let me go back to the PowerPoint that I funded. Smaller, less well-built houses, And we have found that, what I was telling you, the higher income people in some neighborhoods use 11 times more energy than low income people in smaller, leaky, uncomfortable buildings. Gas use is much higher than electricity use in LA County, which then poses some very big challenges for the energy transition to distributed generation of photovoltaics.
It's for heating?
Heating, hot water, space heating, and cooking. It's where most places have natural gas. And then we'll go into some more details. So this is what we're doing now, and it will be, we're finishing the mapping by, as I said, late in the fall. So we will cover all of these geographies, which is nearly half of California's population. It's more than half of California's population, actually. The dividing line of population runs right through Los Angeles, between northern and south. So it's a very big, big project, and we're including all of the program data about energy efficiency. So how many people applied for hot water heater replacements, how many people applied for refrigerators, and we're able to then, with the volume of data, to compare to those who haven't within the same socio-demographic characteristics, the same building characteristics, and really begin to see what's worked and what hasn't worked, rather than model data, which is very poorly, it doesn't describe the reality at all. So this database serves as the hub of a fourth set of research projects. And that's the idea, right? The data serves to inform different kinds of questions. So one of our big projects is funded by the state, the planning grant, by the State Energy Commission, the one I just said didn't have any of this data, to accelerate the deployment of what they are calling advanced energy communities, which is decarbonizing those communities. And they had two categories, one for regular advanced or wealthier neighborhoods and one for the disadvantaged. And we chose to compete under the disadvantaged neighborhood. And here are the questions that we are addressing. To what extent can a community's energy needs be met from rooftop and or community solar gardens? What has been the effectiveness of utility energy efficiency programs? And how can we guide municipalities in prioritizing disadvantaged neighborhoods for investments in these advanced energy communities? Because they're the ones who suffer the most from the air pollution impacts and the bad buildings. So this is our neighborhood in red there. It doesn't mean very much to you unless you've been in Los Angeles. So a number of things happen in Los Angeles. I'm not used to this. This is the more wealthy area along the ocean. It's also the cooler area because of the prevailing wind and breezes from the ocean. And as you move more inland, it gets hotter and there's more air pollution. And the air pollution is trapped against these big mountains. They go up to 10,000 feet, it will be what, 3,000 meters? 3,000 meters here. It's all public land. Public land here too, and up in here as well. So it traps all of the air pollution. And as we know, as it's going to get hotter, there will be more hot, very hot days. Not just a few, but very many more. So addressing this area in terms of what the potential for transition is very important. This is a low-income community, mostly of Latino speakers. And they are in a community where there's no city. They're represented by the county. And the county is huge. There are five county supervisors, each of which represent 2 million people. So it's very underrepresented in many ways. So the different colors here show the analysis that we were able to do of the, it's a little fuzzy in the end. Is this too much detail, or is this interesting? It's okay? All right. Because I can go faster if you prefer. These here say single family, the different kinds of building land uses, right? And then the count of each one of those. So we've done a very, very detailed analysis of this specific little neighborhood. Lots of schools. And we've done the total, because this is public, so we have not revealed individual energy use, but we've aggregated it. Total electricity consumption. So you can see the top, the small amount of industrial uses much more than the other categories, and the multifamily uses the least, right? They're smaller units, and so on. So we needed to know how much energy was used year-round in order to be able to estimate how much solar potential, how much solar would be needed to offset the electricity use. And we've done, this is just an example of a lot more work that was done looking at daily variation. And what we found for the single family, so this is just one snapshot, the single family, that actually, this is the parcel counts. Out of 2,500 single family dwellings, only about 500 could satisfy on their roof the amount of electricity utilized in that home. It's not very many. And that's not even counting natural gas. So if you want to offset the natural gas by putting in an electric hot water heater, electric stove, electric heating, that curve moves far much farther this way. That's a very sobering finding. Because this is a very small area, and we're looking at only a small subsection within that small area. And if you think about the energy needs on the regional scale, and we, the desire to supply your energy from the locality, rather than having big solar power plants out in the desert, which would be the alternative, having huge impacts on that ecosystem, it really raises a lot of really important questions about the urban network, the way the buildings are built and so on. So that's one finding for this planning grant. The next finding is that in California, $1 billion a year, that's a lot of money, is spent extracted as a fee from every time you pay your electricity or natural gas bill, you have a surcharge for energy efficiency programs. $1 billion a year. And so we have all of the data from the Southern California Edison, which is the electricity bill, billing, electricity company, and we have all this data about who's applied, and for what. Right? So we have, as I said, we have a huge amount of data to be able to say, well, in this particular neighborhood, what's possible, what could, what might have happened, what can we do to reduce energy use using these conventional programs. So we we're developing that, and we're calibrating the outcomes to develop a plan for transition. And what we show is, overall, less than 5% of electricity users apply for these programs. Pretty low rate. The lowest income quartile, barely 3% apply at all. And then they tend, who gets the rebates? People who live in newer houses, owners rather than renters, which makes sense. They have higher incomes, they have lower population densities, they're mostly white, they're higher educated. And so the program doesn't even touch those who are the most in need. And that is because of a number of reasons. If you try to apply for one of those programs, it's so complex you can't figure it out. I've tried to apply. I have a PhD. I can't even figure out how to apply for one of these programs. Although, as you saw, a PhD doesn't necessarily mean very much in terms of being able to negotiate things. So the question the results raise are several. Can California achieve existing building energy use reductions through incentives alone? No. And yet there's a lot of emphasis on in a neoliberal political and economic regime of having the individual responsible for change, right? We want all individuals to reduce their energy use, and so we will provide you this monetary incentive to do so. So it's not working very well. So then what? And then the next thing was the potential for local solar energy sustainability. It's not sufficient. Without big changes in consumption, which mean the buildings have to change substantially in order to be able to do that. So it really, through having the basic energy data, allows us to look at things in a very granular, realistic way that a modeled approach would not do. You just would, because the models are built on models, and they are not tested in reality. I can go into more detail about that. So one of the things we're developing out of this research is a prioritization tool. Where to install distributed energy resources, because not all places are the same. So how we're doing this is we've developed, and this is still in progress, we have the grid capacity, so this would be this box here, that shows all of the electricity grid. So where are the lines, and what buildings do they feed? And that's very important, because if you're putting more solar on the line, it impacts how the grid functions. So we have that. We have the net solar potential, so the roof size versus the consumption. CalEnviro screen is a identification of environmental impact and poverty. So that's a state tool that you can look at each census tract in the state and identify which ones are the most impacted. And then here we have the census and demographics. And so with this four-part analysis, we can begin to target the highest potential places for solar. And then obviously what this does is it integrates all these different spatial data sets with this supporting disadvantaged communities. And right now, we're still working on the metrics, creating a web-based visualization platform that will be added to the Atlas as another link, documenting it, and getting input from stakeholders. So that's going to be a very interesting product. I mean, it's getting pretty close now. So what we show is the potential and constraints for distributed energy generation and the social issues of consumption and building construction. And that's only possible when you have this kind of data and ask the questions. So that's really the Energy Atlas work at this point. And we're applying for other funds. We have a project looking at the potential of installing community-based solar hot water systems. And I was thinking of robots, isn't it? Your work really fits nicely into this. And so it's a platform that is very dynamic and that we can grow in different kinds of ways. The other major project that we've been working on I've been working on this for a long time, is solving the puzzle of local water supply in Los Angeles County. And so this is also an interdisciplinary project. We're just finishing a big National Science Foundation grant. I'm writing the second report now with hydrologists, ecologists, because we need to know how much water the plants in the landscape use, systems engineering, and then institutional analysis. So I don't know how familiar you are with Los Angeles, but Los Angeles is always seen as this cancer on the landscape because we import so much water, and Los Angeles, we hear, should have never been built there, and so on, right? So this is abnormal, this is mostly natural, but that's another story. But, you know, Los Angeles is just a terrible place because of how much water it uses. California is characterized by either too much water or not enough water. We have a very cyclical and extreme precipitation regime that's only going to get worse. And we move water a long way, 800 kilometers from north to south, east to west, not to mention the Colorado River. It's a really very, very engineered system. Of course, China is now far surpassing our engineered system in California with its water transfers, but we have pioneered large-scale water transfers. You know, so we've been unpacking the history of these large-scale water transfers. Why did we end up building these enormous water systems? And there are a number of reasons. We have limited surface water, and the groundwater was there, but not so accessible in the early 20th century. We the urbanization was limited if we didn't have enough water, so we began to find places to bring water from. And the city started first with about a 250-mile aqueduct in the Sierra Nevada that brings water down. Then the big regional projects from the Colorado River and from the northern part of the state. And we realized that we needed to maintain aquifer, the water, the groundwater, so we imported water to put in the aquifers that were then pumped out and then refilled with imported water, kind of a crazy system. And these were the responses to this thought that we had insufficient water in Los Angeles. The water systems in Los Angeles, this is much of the work that I did. It took us a very long time to put all of this together. It's complex. It's historically developed. So one place would urbanize and start a water company. Then the next jurisdiction would urbanize and start another water company. And then the next, right? And so we have over 200 private and public water retailers, different companies. We have 5 municipal water districts, 3 water import agents. Well, as you can see, it's just like a bomb went off in terms of fragmenting how water is managed in the county. So how do you then look at that and say, well, how do we move to a more water self-reliant system with this crazy number of water agencies? Well, the first thing we needed to do was figure out what they are and put them together, kind of like the Energy Atlas, in a systematic, accessible database. So that's what we did. And we created this water hub, which if I can get back to the internet, I will show you. Can you help me do that again? I have it I have it ready to go.
So this
thing. Yes, but if you just go on to Chrome, it's coming.
So we try to do it.
There it is. Thank you very much. So we built an interactive web atlas to show where all of these agencies are. The difference being that we were not able to collect the water consumption data because we don't have the labor to collect 100 plus, 200 data from 200 agencies. And many of them are private and you have to go through a non-disclosure agreement and all this, we just didn't have a way to do it. So what we did was we mined what little public data there is to get some sense of that. What we've done is integrate outdoor water use by putting, by measuring the actual amount of water that the vegetation uses. How much does the lawn use? Yeah, under a tree with boxes, so that the penetration boxes. We put sap sensors in trees, different species of trees in different geographical locations to see how much water the trees actually use. So we have a the most, I think, advanced understanding of how much actual water these actual landscapes use. We have modeled and measured the urban hydrology. We have all those institutions. And then we have all of the engineered, all of the engineered parts of the system. So the sewage treatment plants, the water treatment plants, you know, all of that is in there. And we've developed based on these maps. And we created, or my third course created, a network model and put together this network model for LA Water Management, where he has all of these factors in the model. And then we can begin to move the different pieces around. What if we reduced water use in the home? And we increased recycled water, and we were able to actually project a whole set of changes within realistic assumptions. And to assess local water supply potential given current and future years. And what we find is, as I alluded to, there's a very unequal hydrologic landscape, mostly due to the access to groundwater. There are some places in LA County that have enormous groundwater resources, very, very big groundwater resources that are underutilized. And that's a whole other discussion, but I can go into that at some point. And then we can make all of these trade-offs, and ultimately what we find is that a water-efficient city would reduce the amount of water use dramatically per capita. We would have to shift the landscape to plants that are more water appropriate for the region, because we've had so much water we've been able to plant, you know, plants I recognize from here, or even 60 inches of river, right? But they exist. It's an actual possibility. It's not a fantasy. Industrial and commercial water conservation, and the use of this groundwater in a very different way. So right now, the groundwater is regulated, the pumping is regulated, but the rights are private, by and large. And so if we make the groundwater a common property regional resource, then we can begin to use that groundwater in a way that creates access to the region. We can, in years of very high rainfall, which we do get in California, recharge the groundwater basins with imported water without affecting the places of origin, because there's a lot of water, and manage that system for a very, very long time through water recycling and so on to overcome effects of dry years. We estimate if we could recharge the groundwater basins every 15 years, so you can imagine a heavy rain period at least once in 15 years, the region would become largely water self-reliant, which is completely counterintuitive when you think about Los Angeles. But we think that this approach can apply to many, many, many places in semi-arid environments, actually, today. So it's very exciting outcome. So the conclusions are: we import lots of water. The local water supply goals are mostly constrained by institutions. Of course, institutions are huge, big problem, right? It's fine for me to say, oh, it's just an institutional problem. though you saw all those institutions. Every one of those parts of the water system has a bureaucracy, it has a vested interest, it has income, it has rules and regulations, so it's not a trivial, it's an enormous transformation, actually. But it's not about the water, per se. If that's not the constraint, which is very interesting. It's really an institutional problem. We can cut imports up to 40% with minimal new investments, but we really need to increase the stormwater capture, increase the use, apply much more conservation. And overall, 100 gallons per person per day, which would include institutional, commercial, it's a gross number, would be enough for the region to decide. So it's not a dire future. We're not that, you know, it's not a 5 gallon per person per day future. It's actually a very rich future. But how we bring that political change about is kind of the next phase of the world. So, in sum, I would say we do science of the public interest, and we're driven by goals of environmental justice, resource conservation, and using the power of the university and our power to do research for transformative programs, policies, and practices. And what it requires is what a university can do, and that is the integration of multiple disciplines, of methods and frameworks. So we have spatial science and statistics, ecology, hydrology, energy system science, systems engineering, social, cultural, institutional analysis. And ultimately, the problem with these cities is that we just really require collaborative knowledge synthesis. And it takes a lot of time. I'm sure, given Rin, your experience with the kinds of challenges there are communicating across disciplines, how much time it takes to learn how another discipline gets knowledge, what are the methods, what's legitimate, how you frame a question, how you describe your findings. All of that is a learning process. So it's not just about learning about what's going on out there and gathering the data, but it's about how you work with it internally among all these different disciplines and create an atmosphere of respect and mutual learning. And that's a whole other set of challenges. I've been very, very lucky with the people that I work with, but I only work with some people. Because it can be very competitive, it can be very hierarchical, it can be very unpleasant, actually, to try to work with people who don't see knowledge, the way you acquire knowledge in the social sciences, as legitimate, to be perfectly honest. And anyway, so it's been quite a learning process for me, but I think the outcome show it's really worth the effort in trying to overcome those barriers, both inside the university, but also towards public change on the outside as well. So that's what I've been doing for the past 7 years. Thank you.
So we need to distribute the burden of a lot question time, I think, to different people, because at least one person has a ton of questions.
Yeah, you can have you tomorrow. Yes, so, we're in the space.
So, questions.
Just so
four people raise their hands.
Will you please repeat your name?
Sure, Stephen.
You're Stephen. All right.
Yeah.
Famous Stephen.
Oh, really?
Yes, I've heard about Stephen.
Okay. Very interesting. All this kind of stuff. And self-reliance and self-reliant cities is really something that we're thinking about a lot with food. So we can bring in about some of that stuff. But with the water, I wonder if the model and stuff that you guys created, what, to reach those goals, it sounded like it was within reach.
Yep.
What kind of infrastructural changes would need to happen, or would there not be necessary? Is that one of the things?
Well, do you consider outdoor landscaping infrastructure?
Urban?
Outdoor landscaping.
Well, sure.
Yes. Substantial.
Yeah.
But you know, none of this would happen overnight.
Sure.
This is a long-term process. Mm-hmm. So the infrastructure of water itself, probably not enormous. We would, I think, have to do more wastewater recycling and reinjection into the groundwater. One of the ironic facts about these groundwater basins is that they have been allocated, the space has been allocated to pumpers, right? But there's extra space that could be filled. But under the adjudications, the legal adjudications, that extra space doesn't belong to anybody. And so they don't exist. It doesn't exist. And so the legal framework actually means that there's less water potential than there actually physically exists. So the adjudications will have to be revisited. And how you allocate that water, unless you, in my opinion, expropriate the pumps and make it a public common property resource, is very complex. So, but the infrastructure, we don't even think that you need to do a lot of purple pipe. Purple pipe has all kinds of other problems, including sewage treatment plants that are usually downhill, so then you have to engineer moving water uphill. But the groundwater basins can be accessed with pumps in a distributed way. So it's a, yeah, that answers your question.
What was that purple pipe thing?
Purple pipe is a, so in water, at water plants, they have different colors for the pipes, depending on whether it's it comes into the plant, or whether it's treated and made up to certain standards. Mm-hmm. Now, purple pipe is a recycled water pipe. Okay. It's just known as purple pipe. It's a term of art in the water world. But it's usually not considered potable, even though much of the recycled water is treated to potability. There's a phobia about that, which comes from water abundance. Yes.
So, thanks for your...
Can you remind me your name?
Christoph.
Christoph, you're Christoph, okay.
Thanks for
these names.
Very interesting talk. So you mentioned in the study about the solar potential.
Yes.
That if one-fifth of the households could cover their needs through rooftop solar. And I was wondering why, and I was looking at some, and you said that to increase that, there would have to be some huge changes in consumption.
Mm-hmm.
But if you look at the actual data, like how much water and how much energy is consumed per capita in LA, for example, and then you compare it internationally, then you see that the per capita consumption, for example, for energy in LA, well, say, Japan or Germany is vastly different. So LA uses like maybe 2 to 4 times the amount of energy that's used in other industrialized countries. So it makes me wonder whether it's not more like that might be the pressing kind of issue. Maybe it's not the amount of solar potential that's the problem, but that the needs are just way too high.
Well, that's what I said. Or did that not come across?
Well,
apparently it didn't come across. So it's partly a structural problem, though. So if the appliances that you are able to purchase are high energy consuming appliances, There's not very much you can do about that, because they're big. So in the US, appliances are enormous, right? The refrigerator is the size of those two doors, right? What's the alternative? A refrigerator the size of one door. So structurally, the consumption change is constrained because of the ability to choose something different. The buildings are very poorly built. And one of the things that is extraordinary when you come to Japan is I can look at that light switch, it's straight. Right? That's a trivial example, but construction quality in the US is very poor. And so the thermal envelope is terrible. So consumption, while we overconsume, we have too many things, no question, is also constrained by what you can then choose to buy. So we at home, my house, we have a refrigerator that is this big, right? And that is, the insulation is that thick and uses hardly any electricity at all. It was extremely expensive and very hard to find. There's one kind of artisanal producer of this refrigerator, and what they actually specialize in is coolers and things that you can take out into the field, you know, blah, 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 blah. So it's difficult. It's not impossible. But the kinds of energy conservation incentives that are available will simply never, ever get us there. So we need to be able to talk about that.
So your point was that if you put the blame on the individual to choose responsibly, but there is no right choice, then that kind of makes that point.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we're pushing, because it's a neoliberal regime, right? It's the individual who has to change. It isn't a structural problem. If you just choose right, things will be better. We'll give you a little bit of money to do it. It will never fulfill the objectives of the policy and the goals of the state. There's actually a law in the books now that requires all buildings to be more 50% more efficient by 2030. Okay, fine, that's a great idea. But the tools just don't exist for long. We don't even know how much the buildings use. That's just crazy. So I'm really, part of the intention of this is to provide content that's actionable. My small contribution to moving the planet forward somehow.
And so you're showing the impossibility of using incentives, but are you also sort of suggesting, proposing alternatives to these things?
Well, yes, but they're very radical. I mean, they have to be. So, for example, there should probably be a state regulation that caps the size of buildings or requires them to be so energy efficient that, you know, it's... Yeah. And, or... a square foot assessment on your energy use. I mean, there are ways to do this if you want to capture that problem. But until you've identified the problem, you can't develop any policies to capture the problem.
But so, sorry, there were other people who have been talking, so. Other questions?
I am Paul now.
Yes.
Yes,
thank you.
So I'm doing GIS.
Oh, you're GIS.
So I want to ask about data visualization.
Yes.
And also it's sharing aspect. So you show your beautiful platform built up with the open source CardDB.
Yes.
And this, I agree with you that this data visualization is very powerful
yes.
to bring messages to not only for researcher communities and also local stakeholders, decision makers, that is very informative sources. So, have you ever attempted some interactions with decision makers or stakeholders using this map system?
Yes.
Yes, and how was that effect?
Well, so, the maps and the data in the maps they're being used to develop greenhouse gas accounting frameworks for cities. They are being used by local cities to develop energy efficiency and conservation programs to target certain neighborhoods first. Not as radical as I might imagine in my conceptual imaginary, but they are being utilized as tools for that work. Once the solar prioritization tool is up, it will help localities determine where to put solar, distributed solar energy. So they're being utilized as tools by local governments. We're also working fairly closely with the environmental justice community because they are the ones who suffer the most and they are interested in the energy transition. So it serves as an argument for them to go to the policymaker and say, what about me?
Yes, and for data sharing, they change their mind, for example, release new data or share data as open. Source of the data format after looking for this platform.
I'm not sure I understand the question.
Oh yeah, just I mean, they change their attitude, to view the data in the map, but also they provide new data.
Oh, no. So, the electricity in California and natural gas in California is provided mostly by three large utilities, private utilities. They hate our work.
What's that you do?
Because we challenge their claims about solar potential, right? Because so solar has been seen as a disruptive technology, right? So the big utilities see distributed generation and decarbonization as undermining their business model. Because if you're in the business of selling electricity that's produced by hydrocarbons, and somebody comes along and says, you don't have to buy any hydrocarbons. We can do it through distributed generation with solar PV, et cetera, et cetera. You're undermining their business model. So they are very, very unhappy. And there's a huge, this comes in the context of a huge transition in the state requiring renewables. And the rise of competition to the big utilities by local governments who are organizing their own utilities. And so our work fits into this dynamic landscape of energy change. I can tell you a lot of detail about the institutional organization of the utilities and their regulation in California, but the utilities themselves, they should use this work. But instead, they fight for work.
For one, I'm in love with reality atlas. That's basically what I was looking for the last 3 years. So I'm working on like shallow geothermal energy.
Yes.
And we always have no information at all in Germany about the heating demand. We wanted to generate like your solar potential and your geothermal potential. That's our result data. So
yes.
If I could pick your brain on that, so
okay.
Thanks.
Absolutely.
And then I have another short question on your water hub.
Mm-hmm.
Have you linked that to the water quality data? I know that the USGS has a lot of information on water quality.
So, no, we have not. As many of you will understand, you're limited by your budget, and we've run out of money. So it would be nice to link it to more attributes, but I have to raise more money to do that. So, not yet. And water quality is sort of a dispute about water quality, but it does vary across the region. Some degree, but I would say that within the region, generally, the water quality is generally pretty good. If you go outside of the region, into the Central Valley, Agricultural Valley, then it's a whole other story. There are wells that are, you can't use, there was the blue baby syndrome. I mean, it's really bad because of the pesticides and herbicides and all that. But within Los Angeles County, more or less pretty clean, except for some places where you have hydrocarbon pollution. So they do, they're treating it well, pump and treat, which is a whole other story about it. But good question, yeah.
Yes? I have two questions. One is, you were describing how it's very challenging to get the first the big data is, first of all, and there was a lot of politics involved. I was wondering what the incentives were for these entities, private entities, to give the data to the, what were the incentives that you used it?
Okay.
And then second of all was updates. I think it ties into the funding also, but what are your, how,
so
since this has become a very useful data, it's been recognized as a useful tool, what then becomes that future scenario
right.
For updates?
So in the first instance, the utilities did not give us the data. I was part of a proceeding, a legal proceeding, at the Public Utilities Commission. The Public Utilities Commission is one in every state of the nation. They regulate the private utilities. So the public interest is defended against utility profit making. And the Public Utility Commission balances the rate payer and the shareholder in the company. And so the rates that the utilities charge is this constant back and forth that we need to raise the rates because of stranded assets, nuclear pipelines, other things. The Public Utilities Commission said, well, but it has to be, the rates have to look like this to protect the poor. But anyway, it's a very, very complex system. And about 5 years ago, with state policy requiring reporting of greenhouse gas emissions and reduction of greenhouse gas emissions, local governments could not get utility data because they consider it their private data. My customer, your data is my data. And we will protect your privacy. So there was a hearing, it was a year-long proceeding with many, many experts testifying about data access, including me, showing my little atlas, because I'd gotten paid. And finally, the judge, at the end of the proceeding, developed a set of protocols. Those protocols say that university researchers can get the raw data, the individual billing data, under a non-disclosure agreement where you cannot share that data with anybody, but you can show it with different aggregations. So there are different rules for industrial, for residential. But we actually got the data from a different source, which was within the Public Utilities Commission. There are consultants who get the data. It was very complicated, but we signed a non-disclosure agreement and have been given this data because the Public Utilities Commission sees the value, even though we don't fund it, of the Atlas, because they too realize that the constraint inhibits good public policy. So we've done data requests. Actually, we're starting to do the public data requests of the utilities, and that's a route that we are going to further explore.
When you say you're going to go through that's through the legal process.
Yeah.
Yes. You're going to go to the courts to get this data.
Well, actually, the Public Utilities Commission is requiring them to provide their data, but the quality of the data is poor. All the utilities do, their business, is to provide energy and have you pay for it. The rest of it is really not so important. And so, for example, you have account numbers. You run out of account numbers, you start back from zero. So if you're trying to have a longitudinal database of energy use, which is really important, the account numbers become crazy because you have an account number you're tracking, and then all of a sudden, you have to start over again. So the data handling and figuring out these things is very challenging. We have lots of discussions about this. But I think it's really the frontier of at least in the energy and water worlds, of being able to come up with alternative futures. Because if you don't know anything, you don't know anything. But you have to think about what you want to know. So that was the first question. The second question
is,
updates. So we have now, this was 2010, where the Atlas 2.0 will go to 2014. But we're in the process of actually debating whether we're going to do data requests to get to 2016. But it's only 2017 now, and so it's a little bit, it's pretty recent data, the 2016. The other thing we discovered is many utilities destroy their data. They don't keep it because it's so much data. They don't have room to store it themselves. So after 3 years, it's So the other challenge now is data is being collected by smart meters, and it's hourly or 15-minute interval data. What do you do with 15-minute interval? I mean, where do you put 15-minute interval data for 10 million people? It's just crazy, because the idea is if you get, we can charge you for the time of use, right? And of course the time of use is when you're home and you need your appliances because you've just gotten home, you want to make dinner and do the wash because you aren't going to get up at 2 o'clock in the morning when the energy is cheap to do it. I mean, the whole thing is just totally crazy. So we're trying to open this up for discussion. Because regular people, what are they going to do with a time of use charge? Come home at 8 at night when they have kids that just got out of school? It's just, the whole thing is crazy.
Well, to some degree, such concepts already exist. For example, cheap at night use.
Yes.
That's already used.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I mean, I think there is a potential to offload.
Well, okay. So the Public Utilities Commission in California is the one that negotiates with the utility the time of use rates. And those time of use rates differ by income. And so there's a huge it's hugely complex, the time of use. And it also depends on your climate zone. So I agree with you, those rates exist, but they're complexified enormously by all these other factors. And so to tease that apart, to really know what is being charged is not so easy. We actually did an analysis based on publicly available data of proposed time of use charge changes by the utilities and showed that potentially you could have to pay considerably more money for your electricity because with the duck, well, so in California we're now producing a lot of solar electricity, generating electricity at the highest of the in the afternoon. So much so that we're overproducing electricity in the daytime, and we've had to transmit it to Arizona for free to dump it. So time of use then charges people for the end of the day, right? From 5 o'clock to 8 o'clock, or depending. Well, as we just talked about, structural conditions inhibit conservation, voluntary conservation. Not entirely, but to some degree. The other thing that inhibits conservation is patterns of daily life. So as a parent, I know that electricity will be cheaper after 10 p.m. I kind of like to go to bed and not stay up because it's cheaper, my electricity is cheaper, and I can do my laundry or take my shower or, right? So there's a part of this where, yes, we need to reduce our consumption, but is it really me working with children who is responsible for the entire conservation program? Or is it that we need more opportunity, structural opportunities, to have appliances that use less electricity, to have better built homes so I don't have to turn my air conditioning on when I get home at the end of the day, so my children can do their homework, you know, all of that. There's a tension there, I think.
So building on that, you said that if you have poorer income families in less well-built houses. But on the other hand, you have people who have like really high efficient homes, but they are so huge that they are still consuming, what, like 11 times, I think you said?
Yeah.
So how would conceptually policies look like that try to tackle that problem?
Well, as we were just talking about, we're starting to think about that because we were just finishing that full analysis. And so, should the state have a economically punishing surcharge on houses that are over a certain size? Politically, that would be very difficult. Should you have a per capita surcharge? Oh, you know, I'm not an electricity rate design expert. I don't know. But what we can do is put it in the public sphere so that people who are more expert in those questions can begin to then think about what the trade-offs are. Or maybe if your house is a certain size, you must be off-grid. I don't know what the specific policy response is, but at least we now can say there needs to be some policy responses, because before this was invisible. I mean, I don't mean to offload the question, but rate structures are, that's a whole specialty of its own that I have a glimmer of understanding.
How about prescriptions for appliances and all that? I mean, you could have, if you have a program called washer, you can have them wash during the load, so
Yes.
Smart stuff.
Yes.
Not right.
But then you have to buy new ones that are smart.
Well, you could sort of not allow the production, the manufacturing
right.
of old-fashioned machines, like you had with what's it called, CFKs.
CFCs. Sure. So, yes, California is a state in the United States, and one of the interesting constitutional constraints in the United States is that at a certain degree, and I don't know. I think California has been able to require more efficient cars, but that was because the Clean Air Act allowed California to do that, because there's an interstate commerce set of regulations. I can't remember which one that is. But it means that a state cannot, for certain things, prescribe something that is more severe than another state. Because of interstate commerce. So we would have to ask our president and our Congress, right? And so, there are very real institutional reasons why we don't move forward. But say if the Japanese decided to sell only really efficient washing machines and things to the United States, maybe we would buy them. But have you seen an American washing machine? American washing machines are just like, they're enormous! Things are so ugly.
And they're noisy. And
they're just terrible.
They use warm water, I suppose.
Well, they can. I mean, the Japanese ones look like a little Barbie washing machine. And
they don't use
them. You can't get anything in there.
Right.
Yeah, there's always,
Just washing machines. If they don't use hot water, do they need like more chemicals to get it clean?
Yes, people do compensate. Yeah. I mean,
in Japan, we never use hot water.
I didn't know.
I have one of those here. And in Japan, what you do is, one of the things I think Christoph was trying to touch on is, there are cultural differences around consumption.
Yeah.
That's a good one. So in a Japanese home, if many of the washing machines have a little hose that you can stick into your tub.
I'm in the red house, yes.
It's all wonderful already. But then, when it's gonna get in the wintertime now, we don't heat the whole house. There's only certain rooms,
right.
And the same with cooling and everything. So there's this decentralized kind of piece to it. So my question is, you get the energy, you get the water, and how do they link? Is there linkage? I mean, the most completely.
Oh, the energy water nexus?
Well, that's
that?
We're talking about
that.
Too much, but I mean, we're talking about urban redesign.
Yes.
We're talking about structural redesign and stuff. And there are synergies you can imagine.
Absolutely.
The whole thing is a decentralized, self-reliant kind of future is where you're going for it.
Yes.
So. Where do you see the intersections and stuff, or interesting kind of things going on?
These
two combined.
Well, the energy water nexus has always been slightly puzzling.
Mm-hmm.
So, what does it mean? I'm not sure. We've applied for funding under the energy water nexus RFP, and I'm still not sure what it means.
Well, the nexus is, and I mean, you guys use some of this in your language when you talk, but it's about trade-offs in the end, right? One or the other. Kind
energy
of thing.
Or water?
Yeah, and so, yeah, literally. Like, we're going to use this, it's going to affect in certain ways. But I mean, the question I want to know in this thing, the nexus, hear too much talk about it, is, how these systems need to be redesigned to, work together in certain ways.
Yeah.
So it's not just there's this or there's this. Say, if you, and that, you can see, and then you bring the food in, and you've got it all right there, right? You're really talking about self-reliant urban places, and centers and stuff. Those are the few needs for sure.
Right. So in terms of water energy in LA, there's a lot of debate about tree canopy code.
Yeah.
And I don't even know why we're debating tree canopy code in Los Angeles, because first of all, the urban forest is so bad. Why worry about it? We don't maintain it publicly. A tree is a tree. It could be a crepe myrtle or a gigantic oak. They're all treated under the same rubric. So we need to have a long way to go. It is clear, though, that the one thing we really do know is that trees reduce urban heat. Yeah, they trap urban heat at night, however. Another question. So there's a lot of, there's still a lot of unknowns urban vegetation and water. But we do know we can make a transition to a more water conserving landscape that maintains trees, if you plant the right trees. Now, as far as the other part of the water energy nexus in California, is the highest use of electricity of any sector in California is water. Because in Southern California, there's a mountain range, and the water that comes from Northern California is pumped over that mountain range into Los Angeles. So if we reduce our water imports, we will de facto reduce energy use in the state significantly. So there's a very direct water energy nexus there, and greenhouse gas emissions, and so on and so forth. So that's a very clear connection. We've also started looking at another team that I work with has been looking at the greenhouse gas emissions and energy use of water treatment. So water purification when it comes in, wastewater treatment, all of the aspects of that, moving the water around, cleaning it. And so we have been looking at that. But I don't know what that means in terms of the water energy nexus exactly, because it doesn't mean you use solar to do it. I mean, I don't quite know what that means. But there's a cost. But it's still much less than importing the water. So, and as far as if Los Angeles could become more water self-reliant, it means that there's more water for agriculture, which is a very big deal in California because we irrigate our agriculture. And it reduces the pressure on farming for water. Even though everybody says, well, why do we grow rice in California? Because it's so water consuming. Well, you have to grow it somewhere. That's the whole thing about food. Food is water. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, all food has water in it. So where you grow it will have an impact somewhere on water. So what are we exporting our water impact to? What, Mexico or something? That's such a stupid argument. I mean, maybe we shouldn't be growing cotton in California.
So, I mean, I don't know about the nexus, but you can think of various aspects of the environment in terms of where you need to be putting in new infrastructure, or where you, as you're saying, so you need to learn to build different types of housing, etc. And you're not going to only do that for electricity production or whatever. You would presumably think about emissions and about water use and sort of.
Well, an embedded energy in the material?
Yes.
Yeah. That's a whole other part of the analysis that needs to take place. What is the actually we've done that for? So the biggest rate of growth in Los Angeles was in the 50s and 60s, and early 70s. So the argument for me is we have all this infrastructure that's been built. We should maximize the use and reuse of that existing infrastructure. I'm writing a paper actually right now, I'm finishing it on a new proposed land development, and how we're not even getting close to accounting for the environmental effects of this, because we don't take embedded energy or transfer lands.
a British Jewish anthropologist. Maybe it seems a bit unrealistic question or maybe discussion.
Okay.
I'd like to know about the population dynamics or maybe the demographic change in Los Angeles area.
Mm-hmm.
And is it increasing?
Slowly.
Slowly.
Mm-hmm.
But still increasing.
Mm-hmm.
Things. And that in some specific area or
Where is it growing?
Yeah. The growing area. Is it very specific areas in a small range or because I want to know that the footprint, for example, of energy or consumption,
mm-hmm.
or maybe in ecological terms, we say some carrying capacity of an area,
mm-hmm.
it will be very heterogeneous within the city. So you mentioned that in a poor people's
mm-hmm.
area spend more energy
per capita. Not per building.
Yeah, of course. So if so, the people who are newly coming to the city
mm-hmm.
should be move to other places. For example, the less suppressing the resources. For example, that if that already many people
mm-hmm.
are living
mm-hmm.
is suppressing the for example the groundwater or the energy consumption at the unit of area, you might guide the newcomers to other places
mm.
not being used for this poor sustainability.
Right. Well, that's impossible in the US.
Okay.
So what I would say is that there's a lot of possibility of intensification in the built area already.
Yeah.
So there's a trade-off between, that's not the right way to put it. We have the possibility of reducing the impact of existing land use very much.
Yeah.
We can reduce the amount of water, we can reduce the amount of energy used, and so we can add more people to those places because there is room for much more intensive, an intensification of density.
Yeah.
We're very, even though the region is the most dense in the United States, surprisingly enough, it's still not dense.
Okay.
The opportunity, I think, in Los Angeles is in these vast zones of single family homes to build apartments, to transform the big houses into apartments,
mm-hmm.
subdividing them. Mm-hmm. And if you're using less electricity and less water per capita, you are not having a big, you're not changing the impact from what it is now. And so the tendency in the United States is to grow outward because we have so much land compared to Japan and we don't.
Yeah.
It's not comparable at all. But I don't think we can actually afford to do that in terms of materials, in terms of commuting. We don't have the infrastructure. We will not build the infrastructure much because it's so expensive.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of the ecological impacts and so on, we need to intensify and densify.
Yeah, yeah.
But then it raises all these questions. How do you do stormwater infiltration?
Mm-hmm.
Where do you put the vegetation? Can you have gardening? right? So there are the trade-offs between what is what are kind of typically thought of as sustainable cities, infrastructures, become harder to implement in a dense urban environment, right? Because you have more pavement, you have more higher buildings. Well, how do you do solar, distributed solar, if you have a six-story high building, even if you don't use very much per unit? So there, these are really big conundrums, right? So that's kind of what we work on.
How big is your team?
I have about 10 people.
Only 10.
Feels like a lot to me. Raising the money for 10 people? Oh, God.
All this stuff for government.
I guess, yeah. You're welcome.
All right.
Well, thank you very much. Great questions. Good conversation.